So today we're going to be analyzing the goalkeeper position of collecting aerial balls or crosses. This position is very frequent in any type of soccer game, so we'll get to it. So the most difficult part of this position is when you bring the knee up and you catch the ball at the highest point. So the most difficult thing is keeping a strong core, especially when you leave the ground and you're in the air. Second thing is grabbing the ball at the highest point. So when we're thinking of a coach, you want to catch the ball at the highest point so that we take away any type of potential strikers or defenders getting in the way. And then, of course, collisions with strikers or defenders. And that comes from protecting yourself with that knee, which I'll talk about in the next one. Some coaching points here is you want to bring the knee up for three different reasons. The first one is to protect the goalkeeper, especially when you're going into a bunch of players just to grab that ball. The second one is to generate explosion. So you drive that knee up, it helps with your vertical. And then the last one is going to be to threaten field players. When field players come and they try to score, when you bring that knee up, it makes sure that you know that you're coming for that ball and they might think twice coming for it later. First, starting off with the bones, we're going to start with the cranial bones. So to start off, we're going to start with the frontal bone, then we move to the temporal, and in the temporal bone, we have the styloid and the mastoid process. That's going to help the jaw movement. And then we have the occipital bone, and then we got the mandible. All right, moving on to the vertebrae. We talk about one single vertebrae. We have the body, the spinous process, and then the transverse process. And then moving on to the whole column, we have the 7 cervical that start with the atlas and then the axis. Then we have the 12 thoracic and then the 5 lumbar at the bottom. All right, so moving on to the CSR joint. First, it's gonna be the clavicle that comes across here. And then we have the sternum, and the sternum's got the xiphoid process, the manubrium at the top, and then the jugular notch right above it. And then lastly, we have that rib. All right, now moving on to the shoulder. First, we got the scapula back here, and then we have the spinous process that runs across the top. And then we have the acromion process, and then the coracoid process, and then the glenoid fossa where that humerus sits in. And if we turn around, we have that clavicle that runs across, and then we have the humerus, of course. We have the greater tubercle, the lesser tubercle, and then that deltoid tuberosity where that deltoid attaches. So moving on to the elbow joint, we'll start with the humerus, and we'll start with the medial epicondyle, the trochlea, the capitulum, and then the lateral epicondyle. And then we have the radius, the radial tuberosity, and then we have the ulna with the ulnar tuberosity, and then we have the olecranon process that sits right in that trochlear notch. All right, now moving on to the wrist joint, we'll start with the styloid on both sides, and then we have the head of the ulna, which is right here, and then we have all the carpals in the hand, where we have the trapezoid, the trapezium, the capitate, the hamate, the lunate, the trochlearum, and the pisiform, and then we have the metacarpals and the phalanges. All right, so moving on to the hip joint, we'll start with the ilium, starts with the tubercle at the top, and then we have the crest and then the spine that goes down, and then we have the sacrum in the middle with the ischium and the pubis on the bottom, and then we have that acetabulum where that femur sits in, and then on that femur we have that greater trochanter, the lesser trochanter, and then on the posterior side we got that gluteal tuberosity. All right, next is the knee joint. So we'll start with the femur, and medially we have the medial epicondyle, the medial condyle, the lateral condyle, and then the lateral epicondyle. And then we have that tibia inside here with the tibial tuberosity, and then we have that fibula outside here, and we have that patella that sits right on top. Okay, next is the ankle joint. And so we have that tibia and fibula, and on those outsides we have the malleolus. And then we have the talus with the navicular and the cuboid, and then the 3 cuneiforms as well. And then we have those metatarsals and the phalanges. All right, so now we're gonna analyze the joint actions and then the different types of joints as well. So we're gonna start with the head to the vertebrae. That's a condyloid joint, and it's gonna be kind of in a hyperextensive state just because it's not exactly straight because he's looking up. Next is going to be that vertebrae, and that's all pivot joint, and those are all gonna be in complete extension. And then next is going to be the protraction of the synovial joint, of that CSR joint, it's gonna be in protraction. Next is going to be that shoulder, the ball and socket joint. It's gonna be in flexion because the arms are raised, It's going to be in slight adduction because they're going to be held together. And then protraction of that scapular, only because he's reaching forward. So that scapula will be in protraction. All right, so next is the elbow. This is the hinge and the pivot joint. And so that hinge is going to be in extension because that arm is straight. And then that pivot is going to be in slight three-quarter to full pronation, turned out to catch the ball. So next is going to be the wrist joint. It's condyloid, and then that one is also going to be in full extension. The hand and finger joint is going to be gliding. That one's also going to be in extension, and the fingers is going to be in extension as well. Those are hinge joints. So, and that thumb, that saddle joint, is going to be the thumb, and that one's going to be in abduction as well as reposition. So it's going to be out and then back as well. Okay, so now we're going to analyze the lower joints. And we'll start with the hip. It's a ball and socket joint, and this one is going to be in flexion. The knee, the hinge joint, is also going to be in flexion as well. Then we'll move on to this ankle, which is going to be in flexion. Not in this position, but when we're on the field, the ankle is kind of pointed down a little bit more, and so that one's going to be in flexion, as well as the toes and the foot and toes. Those will all be in flexion except for the toes. The toes are going to be in extension in that position. All right, so now we're going to talk about the muscles and those in this action here, in this position. So first, for the head, neck, the head, back, and chest, and the trunk as well. The muscles that are going to be used are the occipitalis, keeping that head upwards, the splenius, the multifidus, and the spine as well. And then the erectors, all of the erector spinae, and that back will be contracting. We also have the iliocostalis lumborum and the quadratus lumborum as well, contracting there. Eccentric contractions are going to be the rectus abdominis and the platysma to control that head movement, and as well as controlling that extension of the back from the rectus abdominis. Next, in that shoulder, the muscles that are be in contraction is the serratus anterior, the pec minor, and the pec major, the levator scapulae because of that protraction of the scapula. Then we have the anterior and lateral deltoid, and then we have the triceps brachii for the extension of the arm. Then we have the supraspinatus across the top of the scapula, and then the superior trapezius, the top part of the trapezius, and then the coracoid brachialis that runs in here. Next, in the elbow, we have that pronator because those hands are in pronation for catching that ball, and then also the triceps brachii across the elbow joint. So in the wrist, we have the extensors of the forearm because that wrist is in extension, and then also extensors of the forearm for the hand and fingers as well. All right, so now we're going to analyze the muscles of the lower part of this position, of the lower body. So in that hip, we have flexion. And so those muscles are going to be that iliopsoas as the antagonist, that rectus femoris as well running with it, the sartorius, the pectineus, the gracilis, and then all those adductors, the brevis, magnus, and longus. And then that gluteus maximus is going to be that eccentric contractor. Into the knee, we have the biceps femoris. That's going to keep that knee in flexion, as well as the semitendinosus, the semimembranosus, and the gracilis as well. And then as an eccentric contractor, we have that rectus femoris. Into that ankle, in this position, he's standing on the weight, but in a real position, we're going to have flexion of that foot. So when it's pointed down, we have contraction of the gastrocnemius and the soleus as well to keep that ankle in flexion. Of the foot and toes, that is in flexion. That's just flexors of the foot. And when those toes are in extension, that's extensors of the foot that run to those phalanges. All right, so moving on to strengthening exercises for this position. One of the big muscles that we use is the iliopsoas of the hips. And one way that I would strengthen it would be to do kettlebell step overs. So you see Zach doing them here. That really works that iliopsoas and a little bit of that rectus femoris in order to strengthen that muscle. All right, another muscle used a lot in this position is the deltoids or the shoulders. And a exercise that I would give a client coming in to better that position is the barbell push press. So Zach's doing that here. We get in a little bit of squat, using some momentum, press the bar up, catch it, and we really strengthen those deltoids in this position. All right, now moving on to exercises that mimic this position. We're going into some explosive movements. We're going to do the dumbbell squat jumps. All right, this is going to teach a lot of explosiveness in those leg muscles.
Come on, right into it.
All right, so next, another mimicking exercises is of the shoulders. And we want to hold the dumbbells in a neutral grip. We're gonna do some front raises. And we wanna do these standing. While we do these standing, we wanna do these standing to engage the core in order to kind of work that anterior kinetic chain, which also kind of provides a little bit of help on the athletic side of things. Okay, next, another mimicking exercises for the iliopsoas or the hips is we're gonna do kettlebell foot knee raises. This mimics that explosive hip movement in that position. All right, so next we're talking about those muscle fibers that are used in a goalkeeper and in this position specifically. So most of the fibers are going to be fast twitch glycolytic. This incorporates like the kicks, the dives, explosiveness, all that stuff. But also there will be a little bit of slow twitch muscle fibers, especially in the erectors as well as the lower back, especially when you're standing for a really long time as a goalkeeper and there's not a lot of movement going on in the back during a match. Those slow twitch muscle fibers will be in those spinal erectors. All right, so now onto contributing systems of the body that contribute to this position of the sport. The cardiovascular system helps with the bones and muscles by distributing blood, vitamins, minerals, electrolytes, nutrients, and all that to all the muscles and organs in the body. Athletes train that have efficient hearts. That's when they pump more blood and can pump more quickly for longer periods of time. Right, now with the digestive system, on game day, it's really important to make sure you have the right nutrition at the right time. So about 3 to 4 hours before a match, you're looking to intake some high carbs, moderate protein, low fats, and low fiber to maximize energy and power by the time you perform. That could be eggs on toast or pasta. And about 45 minutes to an hour before, you can have a nice snack, and you're looking to intake high carb, low protein, low fat as well. That could be fruit or an energy bar. And after, of course, moderate carb to replenish those glycogen levels in the muscles. And then you want some high protein to repair those muscle cells. Now the respiratory system is a great system that contributes to helping you on game day. It sends oxygen to the muscles, working with the heart and the cardiovascular system. And thanks to myoglobin, those cells can hold that oxygen in that blood so it can be received by all those muscles that are you're getting all that work on game day. Our next is the endocrine system, or the hormones as well. So a big one is going to be for strong muscles, is going to be the growth hormone. For strong bones, is going to be calcitonin. And then strengthening of the muscles and bones, for males at least, is testosterone. And increasing energy and metabolism is going to be thyroxine. And then turning glucose into energy is insulin. Breaking down the glucose is glucagon. And then for game mode, it's glucocorticoids to reduce the inflammation that is made in your body for minor injuries during that match, and then epinephrine for the action and adrenaline. All right, so lastly, the contributing system of the nervous system. And so the frontal cortex of the brain is going to be where that premotor and motor is, and so that comes with visualization and then actually carrying out that visualization in the game. Next is parietal, and that's going to be touch, and then that internal GPS of awareness as well. Temporal lobe, that's going to be experiential memory, and then of course sound, that's what you hear in the game and based off of you know, those reactions from what sounds you hear. Occipital is next, and that's going to be sight, seeing, plays, and judging the path of the ball in case of the position of that goalkeeper is judging that ball path so you can get it at the right point. And then the cerebellum, that comes with proprioception, which is huge in athletes, and then that goes into the joints, balance, and then awareness, which helps that occipital lobe when you're judging the path of that ball so you can get it at the highest point. Afferent or sensory neurons, they send that message from the ball that's been crossed, and then your brain decides that it's time to go out and get it at a certain time. So it sends a message to the muscles from the brain via efferent or motor neurons, and it travels to those muscle fibers, and then those neurons lay in those muscle fibers, and they tell which sarcomeres to fire in order to contract, and you have that best fluid movement to catch that ball at the highest point.